With a bit of help from Derek, I can get this old, underpowered 1.5-litre four-cylinder engine out of the car.
To access the current engine and gearbox, we need to remove a whole host of things. The prop shaft, exhaust, gear shifter and clutch linkage, plus a few engine mounting bolts. And then, with a little luck and a good wiggle, we can extract that old engine.
Right, ready?
Yep.
Right, a little bit further. Look at that.
Yes.
We're out. It's free.
The engine, it is small. It's a lot smaller than the Pinto engine that I've asked Mike to buy to go in here. But I think what strikes me more than that is the shape of the hole that the engine's got to go into.
But given the struggle we've had getting this engine out, that's definitely a problem for another day.
Oh, mate, that is going to be tight. This is a cross-flow engine, so it's got the exhaust on one side and the inlet on the other side, whereas that one over there, well, it doesn't. It's all on one side, so it definitely seems wider. I mean, I've no idea if or even how this is going to fit in here, but somehow it has to. And the only way I think we're going to find that out is by lifting it up, offering it into position and see what we need to cut away to make it work. OK. OK, bring her in and then we'll have to come down a little bit. There we go. All right. I'm just going to have to go around the other side. I'll tell you what, from this angle, it looks even tighter. It's just sitting on the sump and the anti-roll bar. Oh, yes. It's over the anti-roll bar.
Yep.
Sat on the chassis member now, and there is no way this is going to go through here. We need to take off that fuel pump because that's going to start interfering with this chassis rail. I think the inlet manifold's probably got to go because there's no way that's going to fit. I'll move the crane to the front of the engine. We'll try and come in at a steeper angle, yeah?
OK, sounds a plan.
I've stripped everything I can off this side of the engine. So if it doesn't go in now, well, we're in all sorts of trouble.
First, we need to jack up the front of the auto gearbox and start angling it in.
Here we go. Okay.
Keep coming.
All right.
It's an incredibly tricky job as the gap in the chassis is just so tight. Thank goodness for Derek, as there's no way I could do this by myself. It takes delicate manoeuvring to fit the gearbox through the chassis crossmember and into place.
Is it going to get... Oh,
there
look
we
at
go.
That. I'll tell you what, it looks like we've got enough room on the right-hand side here, so that's definitely helped. How's that?
Elvis, it's in.
It's in?
It's in. Yes, seriously.
Fantastic.
Wow.
All right, we haven't got a manifold on or a fuel pump, but... Oh, that's such a relief. It actually fits in the hole. Of course, this engine was never designed to fit in here, and because of that, the engine mounts on the side of the Pinto's block don't match the engine mounts in the car itself. I mean, of course they don't. Well, that is where I'm going to have to fall back on my F1 experience, because it's kind of the same thing. You can't go and buy parts for an F1 car off the shelf. If you have a problem, you have to go back to the drawing board. You design something. That's what I absolutely love about motor racing. So I'm kind of looking forward to this. Come on, I do not need this at this time of the day. Just come out.
I can't see what it's attached to.
Come on.
It's got to come out, Elvis.
Oh. I'm just exhausted, mate. I'm exhausted. Hold on. I see what it is. It's a speedo cable just snagged on a bracket on the chassis.
Really?
That's all it is. We need to drop the engine down a little bit, push it over to the left, and it'll fall out, mate.
OK.
Oh, goodness me.
Coming down?
Yeah. Just going to lever it over, Derek.
Yeah.
OK, mate.
You winning?
Yeah, give that a go.
Go.
I think that might be it.
OK, going up.
Yep, that's it.
Yeah.
It's free. Oh, I'm starting to fall out with Colin. Excuse me for speaking with my mouth full, but there's just no time for lunch right now.
After the huge effort that it took to get that Ford Pinto engine into this tiny little Bedford engine bay, I'm pleased to say that Derek and I have been really busy getting all the other jobs up to speed. We've had a prop shaft remade to suit this Ford rear axle that Mike found online. It's perfect width, it's the right final drive ratio, we've got some wheels to suit the stud pattern, and with only a few minor modifications to things like the mounts and bracketry, we're able to use the original leaf springs onto it. I found an old Ford Cortina handbrake cable that just about kind of works with a minor modification. I had to remake a linkage rod up here. But actually, although it was a massive effort, it's come together really nicely. Although there's still a lot to do. So, whilst Derek prepares the car's bodywork for a respray, I'm turning my attention to another challenge that's arisen with the modifications that we've made. When I replaced the engine, I also upgraded to an automatic box too, which should make it a much more relaxing drive when Colin finally gets himself back on holiday. So the automatic gearbox sits down here behind the engine and underneath this floor pan, so it might seem obvious to put the automatic shifter in this space too, but I can't. The handbrake's in the way, and that means adapting this manual three-speed gear lever mounted up on the column into an automatic shifter mechanism. By moving the gear lever inside, you can see what happens here. It's connected via this rod, and that movement there, that's the forward and back motion between, say, first and second gear. Now, if we move it in a different plane, that way, that's the sideways movement going across the gate. Our automatic gearbox doesn't have a gate, so we don't want that motion. Now, I think I can weld these two pieces together, physically locking them in place and preventing that movement from happening, just leaving us then with that. The forward and rear motion between park, neutral and drive on our auto box. And all I've got to do is connect the two up. Because I'm going to weld this and it will then be fixed forever, I want to make sure that the gear lever on the inside is in the right location so that it's comfortable. When you turn the wheel, you don't bash your knuckles on it. You just find the right distance from the wheel there, mate.
How's that? That good?
Good, yeah?
Yeah.
Perfect. In that case, I'll get it welded up. Nice. Derek, just give it a bit of movement.
OK, how's that?
Perfect. Excellent. Looks good. All I've got to do now is connect that up to the gearbox. And the last part of this job is to connect up this linkage, which eventually runs all the way up to the lever in the cockpit, to the selector on the side of our auto box. We've been incredibly lucky here because that is the original rod that came with the car and it is exactly the right length. Look at that! Derek?
Yo.
Still up there? Still awake?
Yeah, Josh.
Just give it a go on the gear lever, mate. See if it will select. It's all hooked up. Yes! Look at that, it works! It's all clear, it's not interfering with anything. It's a lot of luck and I'll take it. Mechanically, the camper's nearly there, but Colin is still some way off being ready for his holiday snaps. And so Derek and I have put a lot of time into preparing the bodywork, getting this thing ready to go into the paint shop. To do that properly, we need to get rid of this mouldy old roof.
We paid just £4,500 for Colin. Engine and automatic gearbox, £1,000. Rear axle and prop shaft, £220. Re-upholstery of the seats, £1,000. Interior fixtures and fittings, £1,067. Canopy and roof upgrades, £395. Paintwork, £2,000. That's a transformative total of £10,182.
I'm going to tell you, it smells absolutely delicious in it. It really does.
It does from out here.
So one sausage or two?
Definitely two.
I've got a funny feeling we've nailed this. What with the retro styling? But we've sort of updated it at the same time.
Yeah, yeah, you've done a cracking job, honestly. You've smashed it inside there. And this cabinetry as well. Amazing. And you've tied in the colour scheme, the flooring, the roof, the... I mean, even the kettle. Look at that colour code. It's all about those details, isn't it?
Shall we get outside and enjoy the great outdoors?
Definitely.
Click here to subscribe.